Hi, this is Alex with weblabpro.com, and in this video I'm going to show you how to start your very own website. We're going to first start off with a little theory, then we're going to get hands-on step by step. I know starting a website might sound a little scary at first, but believe me, it's way easier than you think.
Now this applies to any kind of website, whether you're starting a personal blog or building a professional website of any kind, big or small, whether it's an e-commerce site, membership site, or for a local business. Basically, this works for any type of website idea that you might have. I'm going to go fast, but don't worry, because at the end of this video, I'll have resources for you where I break this down step by step. Let's start. The three things you'll need are a domain name, web hosting, and the actual website itself. Okay, let me explain this in reverse order, that way it'll make sense. The actual website itself, at its core, is a collection of text files that are written in some web programming language, mainly HTML, which are linked in a logical way. So when you open one of these files in your web browser, it gets opened up as a web page. You'll have your header, menu, graphics, or whatever has been coded in that particular file. Traditionally, you would hire a web designer or developer to build this site for you, but it's all point and click now for the most part, and you'll see this in a little bit. Now, in order for your website files to be accessible to visitors on the internet, the files have to be stored on a computer that is running all the time and is configured with web server software. And it's got to have a really fast internet connection, that way it can handle lots of visitors. That's where web hosting comes in. A web hosting company runs data centers that have industrial grade computers running on all the time, 24/7. And they rent you memory space so you can upload your website on their web servers and have it available to the world. The web server, just like your computer at home, has an IP address assigned to it by its internet provider. Now, a domain name is your very own .com, .net, .org name. This is your web address. A domain name gets linked up to that IP address, which is a bunch of numbers that aren't easy to remember. That way, you'll have an easy to remember word or phrase that is your web address. And that's it. Those are the main things that you need to get a website working. Here's the plan. Register a domain name, get a hosting account, and then upload my website to that server. So that way when a visitor types in the web address in their browser, that domain name will point to our web host, which will serve the site back to that visitor. Okay, let's get to that first step. Let's get the domain name. A domain name is registered through what's called a registrar. And for example, GoDaddy.com is one of the more popular registrars out there. They're one of those companies that offer both domain and hosting. Although I only use them for domain registration services because I currently prefer other web hosting companies. I usually prefer to register the domain name with a different company than I'm hosting with, mainly to keep organized, but also it makes it easier when you decide to change hosting companies. They always change the look around, but you'll generally have a place where you can search for the name that you came up with to see if it's available. Enter the name that you come up with, and if it's available, buy it. It's a simple online shopping process. They'll try to upsell you on lots of things, like email and hosting, etc. Don't pay extra for email because it's part of hosting, and you'll get that with your hosting provider. One decision that you'll need to make is whether you want your domain information to be private or public. You have to understand that when you register a domain, you'll submit information on who is the owner of that domain. So make that decision for yourself. Then finish up, go through the rest of the shopping process. Domains are fairly inexpensive. And once you're done, you'll have access to a control panel, which we'll revisit in just a bit to set some options, which will link your domain to whatever hosting provider you decide to go with. Now let's set up a hosting account. At the time I'm making this video, I mainly host with HostGator. I prefer them. I've tried pretty much all the main hosting companies, and for now I prefer HostGator. If I find a better one, I'll list it in the resource page on my site. It'll be in the description of this video. Alright, so we're at HostGator.com, and typically when purchasing hosting, you'll have a few options to choose from. Shared web hosting, and the more advanced virtual private servers, or hosting on a dedicated server. This is a whole subject in itself, so we're only going to cover shared web hosting here because the others require more technical experience to get up and running. And shared web hosting is plenty good. It takes thousands of visitors per day to outgrow share hosting. And if you're in a position where you have thousands of visitors daily, that's a good problem to have because with that kind of traffic, you can make a significant amount of money off your website if you know how to monetize. And that's also a whole different other subject as well. So for shared web hosting, they offer three packages. Here's the main reason why there's a price difference. The basic account will limit you to having only one domain hosted on one account, while the business plan includes private SSL and IP address. If you're planning on accepting credit card payments directly on your website, like an e-commerce style website, then this is required. So we'll go through the shopping process, and if we didn't buy the domain name through a different registrar, we would be able to do it here. They'll give us that option. But since we already have one, we'll change this and specify our existing one. Make sure you spell it correctly. This is important. Then it's a typical shopping cart process. They'll also try to sell you many other things. I generally don't get any of them. Well, because they're really extra things that you really don't need. But feel free to make your own decision. When you're done, you'll be sent an email with name server information and login access to your control panel. Now we have the foundation in place for our website. Let's adjust some settings and set one up. First thing you need to do is link your domain name to the web host that you signed up with. If you chose to register the domain name with the web hosting company when you purchased your hosting account instead of registering with a different registrar like we did earlier, you don't have to set up this option because it's preset for you. But since I purchased my domain name from GoDaddy, I'll have to set up what's called the name servers to point to HostGator's web server. The name server information is almost always sent in that first email that you get after signing up. If it's not there, it's listed somewhere in your control panel. There's usually two or more, and that's to have backup in case one goes down. They look like web addresses, and for our hosting account, they are ns8089.hostgator.com and ns8090.hostgator.com. So we'll take these and submit them to our registrar. We'll log into GoDaddy, find our way to the control panel for domains, and under the domain that we purchased, we'll set the name servers to point to that web host. And that's it. That's all you have to do here to point your domain to your web host. Just a quick and important side note about name servers. Whenever you change these at your registrar, it can take hours for any computer that has visited the site to recognize that they have changed. So if you visit your domain name and the new server doesn't get pulled up, that's because your computer has saved in its DNS history the old name servers. But you can manually clear this history for your computer by flushing your DNS cache. I'll have more on this on my site on how to do this for other operating systems. It's very easy. If you do a web search on flushing DNS, you'll find all kinds of examples. Now we can access our new working domain. But when we arrive at the site, there's nothing there because we haven't uploaded a working website to the server yet. So let's do that now by logging into the server's control panel. Most web hosts use cPanel as their web server management control panel. It's the most popular control panel among web hosts, so if you decide to go with another web host, you more than likely will see the same thing. One way you can access your server's control panel is to type in your domain name / cPanel, then use your login info to get in there. The email with the login info will also have a link to this control panel. Once you're in, you'll be presented with lots of icons that can control lots of different aspects of your account. It's configured just right, so there isn't really anything you need to do unless you know what you're doing. Really, the few things that you'll want to visit is email accounts. This is where you can create your own email accounts at your own domain. Logs so you can check traffic stats for your site. And finally, the software section. This is where we'll install a pre-built interactive website that we can customize ourselves without technical web designer skills, all by using our browser point-and-click style. Sometimes web hosts configure their control panel differently, but generally you'll see one of these: Fantastico, Simple Scripts, or Quick Installs. They are software libraries which enable you to install very easily some of the most popular open source web applications available for free. These web applications are the third thing that you need. This is the actual website, but it's not just a simple HTML website where you have to rehire a web designer to make changes in the code anytime you want something updated on your site. These sites are interactive, and you have access to the control panel from where you can customize the look, functionality, and content of your site. They're called CMS, which stands for Content Management Systems. By far, one of the most popular is WordPress. Some of the most popular sites on the internet run on WordPress. You'll find it in the blog section because WordPress started out as a blog, but it's evolved into a fully functional content management system. With WordPress, you can build an e-commerce site, a membership site, or manage any kind of site. and obviously a blog as well. Okay, let's install it. Click on it and select New Install. If you have multiple domains, select the one that you want to install it to. And you'll have a choice if you want to install it to the root of the site or into a subdirectory. We'll install it to the root, so we'll leave this field empty. A scenario where you would want to install to a subdirectory is if you already have a working website and would like to add WordPress to that site. And if you install it into a subdirectory, your site will not be accessed if visitors type in just the domain name. They would have to enter the subdirectory as well, and that doesn't make sense. So we're going to install it as the main site by installing it to the root. There's a few other fields that you have to fill out, username and password that you want for the control panel of WordPress, your site's name, description, etc. You can also change these from the WordPress control panel. So now you install it, and a few moments later, your website is up and running and waiting for you to customize it. If we visit our site, now it's working and we have the default empty site up. To access the control panel, go to whatever your domain name is, .com/wp-admin, enter your login info, and then we arrive at the control panel. And from here, the fun begins. You can add blog posts, pages, change the appearance by downloading new themes, control how the menu appears, download plugins to enhance functionality. There's lots to WordPress, and this video is not about that, but there's tons of information on the web about it. There's also some videos on my site on the page that's dedicated to this video to help you get started with WordPress, kind of like a little mini tutorial. That's it. I hope this video has helped. I realize there's quite a bit of information to take in at first, but it's really easy. I've created a page, like I mentioned earlier, on my site at weblabpro.com dedicated to this video that breaks this all down. There's more videos there to help you get started. Check it out. There's a link in the description of this video. Share it, subscribe to my channel, and that's it. I'll see you in the next video.